Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for being patient with us today. We had a few technical difficulties. Always when we do these town halls, I shouldn't say it's always challenging, but every once in a while we get thrown a curve and we've got to figure out a different way to do it. So our lead negotiating attorney, who is supposed to be on virtually with us today, unfortunately can't get on virtually, but he will be on with us through audio only. So you won't be able to see Joe, but you will be able to hear him. So thank you again, everyone, for joining. I'm Julie Hedrick. I'm the APFA National President. I'm really happy you were all able to join with us today. And I'm really happy that we got so many questions from all the flight attendants prior to the meeting. So we're really ready to answer your questions. We're here in Euless, Texas at the APFA headquarters, and we're in our new UniPays office. Before we get started, I'm going to have everyone in the room introduce themselves and where they're based and their years of experience. So Susan, if you'd like to get that started up, that'd be great.
Hi, everyone. So glad you're joining us. Susan Roble. I'm based in Chicago. I've been flying for 34 years, and I'm currently the Chicago Vice President.
Hi, thank you, everyone. I'm Wendy Oswald, and I'm LAX-based. I've been flying for 27 years.
Hi, everyone. Larry Salas, APFA Vice President.
Hi, everyone. My name is Margo Nikitas, and I'm the APFA in-house general counsel. I have 10 years of experience as an in-house union attorney, and a big part of my role here at APFA is to work with the Vice President's Department to file grievances and enforce our contract.
Hi, everyone. I'm Timothy Ligaros, Miami-based, 21st year flying. I started doing base work right after the JCBA in 2015 and joined the team in 2018.
Hi, I'm Reese Cole. I'm based in Chicago. I've been flying for 9 years, and before becoming a negotiator, I was a contract and scheduling rep here at APFA.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Brian Morgan. I'm a Philadelphia-based flight attendant. I've been flying for 29 years. And prior to going on to the negotiating committee, I served in a couple of capacities. One is being vice president of the Philadelphia base and as a regional rep.
Hi, guys. Kelly Hagan, Chicago based. I've been here 9 years as well. And previous to this, I did base work for Miami and also worked on the desk here at headquarters. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, I'm Todd Spitala, a Miami based flight attendant, and I'm also a software flying for years, and I'm helping with the website and technology.
Hi, everyone. I'm Josh Black, APFA National Secretary. I'm also a Philadelphia-based flight attendant. I've been flying for 8 years now, and really glad to have all of you on today.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Before we get started, a lot of the questions that we received over 100, which is great. A lot of the answers are on our website today. So we're going to go over to the website just to kind of show you the new website that we've been working on, and especially the negotiations page, and kind of the setup of it so we can make sure everyone's familiar with it, as well as we're updating this every time we come back from a negotiation session. We're updating with what we've done at the table at that last session. It's really important for us to make sure that you have the knowledge of what's happening at the table today. This is something different. We've never done this before like this for negotiations in the past, where we've actually told you everything that's happening at the table. And we want to make sure that you're all aware of where that is on the website and how easy it is to access, and also that we're always updating. So Josh, if we can, let's just go to the negotiations page on the website. First, it's right there, and let's go to the hotlines. We just put a hotline out today. This is number 11. This was from our session early this month, and it will tell you everything that we did at the table. And we actually have another TA section, which is speaker. So the information from that session is in this hotline. Next, Josh, if we can go to the negotiation status page. And let's scroll down a little bit here, Josh, and let's go to, we presented our opener to the company this last month, and in each of these sections, let's look at compensation, Josh. If you click on them, this is a general overview of what we are going to be negotiating in these sections. Of course, when we negotiate, we always negotiate with the language. And so this is for the opener. It's a general overview of what we will be negotiating in these sections. So as you can see here in compensation, we had a lot of questions about what we're negotiating for. Night pay was one of them. Sit pay, which is in, I think, section 11. We definitely have those on our list. Increase in holiday pay. But if you open up each of those sections, you'll be able to see what we're negotiating for. Josh, let's go down to where we have the TA sections. We now have 16 tentative agreements. A contract has 40 sections, and 16 of those are TA. If you click on one of the sections, let's go to speaker since we just TA'd that. And you'll see the changes that have been made to the JCBA that have been agreed to. Let's go up. Now we're going to go to our tabled sections. So these are sections that we've already opened up. We've already passed proposals back and forth. And normally most of these sections, we have one or two items that we don't agree with the company. And so they're tabled for this time frame. We can look at, let's go to, probably on here, we could look at injury on duty, right? We have a couple items on injury on duty that we are not in agreement with the company yet, or they're not in agreement with us. And so that is why it's tabled. What comes to mind in IOD for me is right now, if you are out at on an IOD or on any medical leave, once you go to unpaid sick, you have a year of insurance benefits. We're trying to increase that to 3 years. That's what we believe is necessary in that, and that is actually what our pilots get. And so that's one of the areas that we're not in agreement with the company right now. Let's go to our next sections, which are the sections that we have opened and that we are currently working on at when we meet with the company. So group accommodations, let's open that one up and talk about that for a minute. Okay, we proposed this back in August. The company has not passed back a proposal yet, probably with good reason. Right around the same time, we filed the grievance for the hotels on what's happening with our hotel situations. We also had a campaign that many of you participated in, that we had emails sent to the company, David Seymour particularly, telling him how important it is that we have a hotel room when we have, when we get to our layover. We should not be waiting for hours and hours and hours for hotel rooms. I know all of you are aware of this issue, but this is one we still haven't received a proposal back from the company yet. If we go to, we probably could go to one more section in that, because most of these, they have, one of the most recent ones we passed is international flying, and we'll be working on that when we meet with the company next week. And then 30 and 31, really, really important sections in our contract, we have passed and we're actively going back and forth on those sections. And if you open them up, you can see what we're proposing. Okay, so we have opened up almost every section of the contract. We have our major sections that we're working on, those are in the opener. And for more information, please, please go to the website and look in the opener and in the other sections so you have the knowledge of what your negotiating team is doing at the table. I also want to mention our contract action team. They have been out in the bases this month. We have a PIN campaign going on. It's very, very important that everybody wears their union PIN today. When we are in negotiations, this sends a clear message to the company that the negotiating team speaks for you. And so the contract action team has been out in about six of the bases so far, I believe. They're in Dallas this week, and they're making sure flight attendants understand the importance of wearing your PIN right now, but also making sure that they're going to the website and that they know the information is there. So you also can sign up to be one of our contract action team members. We have about 1,200 signed up to date, and we're hoping to get a lot more. Josh, can we go to the bottom of this? Oh, there you go. It's right at the top. You click on the sign up, or also you may have seen the badge backers out there that have two QR codes on them. One is to sign up for the contract action team, and the other one is a QR code to take you right to the negotiations page. So it's really important that we get as many of you signed up on that as possible. Okay, what else am I missing here? I think that's about it on that. We do apologize for the short notice of this town hall today. The really good news about technology today is we can have a town hall like this. You can submit your questions ahead of time. We are recording this, and most likely this will be on the website this afternoon for all flight attendants to see. We understand this job well. It's hard for people to bid off. We used to have to in the old days bid off for something like this. Today, you don't need to do that anymore. Today, send your questions into us. We will get as many of those answered as we possibly can. And then you can view this on the website later today, and you can view it, you know, for as long as you want. It'll stay on the website for a long time. So with that being said, one last thing, you can still submit questions at this point. We will try and get to them, but I can tell you we have a lot of questions. We've had over 100. A lot of them were duplicates. A lot of them we're going to try and cover in some of our opener, especially about reserve, which is one of the probably the most talked about section of this contract these days. And also, you can always email the negotiating team or fill out the form on the website and ask and give us the information you want us to receive. So with that being said, Joe, I'm going to hand it over to you. Joe's going to talk to you a little bit about a few things, targeted negotiations, economics, reserve rotations. So Joe, it's take it away.
Hi, everybody. This is Joe Burns here. And I'm the, can you hear me?
Joe's speaking and we can't hear him. Joe, are you on mute by any chance? Because we cannot hear you. Yes. Okay. I think you're back on. Joe?
Hello?
Oh, yay. You made me nervous there for a
minute. All right. You hear me?
Yes. We can hear you.
All right. Hey, everybody. Sorry for the technical difficulties. So I'm Joe Burns. I'm the director of bargaining at AFA, but I am helping out as the with the APFA and your contract negotiations here. I have over 20 years of bargaining experience in the airline industry, and I've also worked in other industries such as healthcare and public employment as well. So we're going to just talk a little bit about the sort of framework for bargaining and where we're at. And then I think the committee is going to walk through more specifics and answer particular questions. But, you know, overall, you know, about a year and a half ago, we decided to do a reset of negotiations where we embraced a framework of targeted negotiations and strategic bargaining. What that means is that we're consciously not allowing management to delay and stall out negotiations, that we are very strategically targeting our proposals to the key issues so that can push the negotiations forward. To that end, you know, we went in and got a lot of the sections either closed out at T8, tentatively agreed, or else we were able to define the issues. So we got one or two issues that we're going to fight out later in negotiations. The other week, we presented the company a opener on the core sections of the agreement. So sick, vacation, all the scheduling, reserve, hours of service, and compensation. And that should be available on the website as well. And these are really the sort of key issues in the agreement that we're going to be bargaining over the next 6 months. So I think it's a interesting time because we're, you know, we've already started talking about sick and vacation. We've gave the proposal on international. We're going to be getting into hours of service and then reserve over the next 6 months. Just in terms of how the negotiation flows, you know, these are difficult issues that we're going to be fighting for because they concern the core work rules. When we're negotiating items such as the economics of how many days of vacation and so forth, we can bargain a little bit with the company at this point, but a lot of those are going to get carried over to the final days of the agreement because they have a cost impact on the agreement overall, and that's going to be dealt with at the end of negotiations. I think we're situated pretty well in terms of pulling together our core issues and trying to bring things to a head, throughout this. And by the end of the year, we're going to be pushing forward and hopefully getting into economic discussions. And I think we just need to be clear about where we're at right now, and we need to look at the industry and what the situation is. Overall, we've got a lot of groups that are out there bargaining in the industry. We've got Southwest Flight Attendants, we've got United Flight Attendants, American Flight Attendants. I'm out here doing a training for Alaska Airlines. They're going to be going into bargaining. So I think a lot of the flight attendants are going into bargaining, and folks have been flying through the pandemic. They've kind of endured a lot over the last period and really want to see improvements. And certainly I know that's what your negotiating committee will be pushing for. On the other hand, we're facing management who really they were able to survive because we fought for and won the pandemic relief. But as is always the case, that'll start going into the rearview mirror. And I think there's going to be a classic struggle going forward because we want improvements, and they're going to be looking to rebuild capital reserves and rebuild their reserves so they can distribute the money to the shareholders. So that kind of sets up a natural conflict, which isn't a bad thing. We are putting together the contract action team. That's why that's essential. We're going to be increasing the pressure on the company to reach an agreement over the coming period. And we're going to be picking fights on particular issues as we get into important scheduling rules and hours of service and reserve rules. We'll be calling on the flight attendants to both be informed and to, back it up by action. So I think we're situated pretty good overall. I did want to say a couple words, and then before I pass it back over, one of the big issues that we're going to be dealing with is the question of reserve. And, it's an issue where, I think clearly everyone understands that the length of time that folks are on reserve is a major problem. Folks who have already put in 15, 20, 30 years still sitting reserve. And there's a real, I think desire to address the issue. On the other hand, we also need to understand that there's a wide variety of views among the flight attendants. And, I think folks need to, have discussions and be willing to look at the various issues about, what we can get the flight attendant group as a whole to agree to. So we'll have a lot more detail coming out in the coming period, especially as we start negotiating reserve. But at the end of the day, we need to remember that, we need to, take on management to get a better reserve system overall. And then we need to, be willing to work together to come up with some solutions that reduces the amount of time on reserve. So at that, I'm going to pass it back to Julie.
Thank you, Joe. Yep, reserve has definitely been a key topic amongst probably the majority of our flight attendants for this negotiations. We hear it all the time. We know how important this is to our flight attendants. I think, Joe, you said 15, 20 years. I think we're looking at 25, 30 years that a lot of our flight attendants are on reserve today. So this is something that as a union, we started talking with our new hires about a couple of months ago, actually back in November. And we actually talked to them about the rotation, but we also talked to them about really the reality of where reserve is at all of our bases and the seniority, and that this is a mandate that our flight attendants have been, asking for us to reduce the reserve seniority. So we are going to talk a little bit about the A days, because we hear from a lot of our flight attendants, and what about A days? Delta has the A days. So we want to kind of talk about the A-Days. We have done research on them. Kelly's going to talk about that and available.
Okay, so let's talk about A-Day. They look really good when you hear people talk about them, but when we dug into Delta's work rules, because they don't have a contract since they're non-union. So everything's subject to change immediately for them. So when we've been digging in it through the years, because it has changed a little bit, their ADs are very different. So in our world, we have line holders and we've got all this pay protection and where you fall in open time with line holders. And then we've got our reserves. And the reserves on our side, we really see those as being used excessively. So over in Delta's world, they try to protect their A-Day people. They covet that pool of people. And what they do is they end up using their line holders kind of like reserves. If you are old LAA, we had old MIC procedures like days originally scheduled to fly that you had obligations on. Their line holders have that. So if they end up getting rescheduled or displaced off a trip, then they give them these A-Days and they're at the top of the pile. So that is very much a different culture for us because our line holders are protected. And we do have the pay protection and we do have the strict reserve rules of last man standing and things such as that, that we do not want to give away. Those are very precious. We fought very hard for those. Going to an A-Day land, we would have to compromise that. We did survey that and it did not actually peg out very high in the survey. I mean, it was like less than a fifth of the submissions that were in were requesting that. So we have taken A-Days off the table. Let's talk about availability. So availability was a legacy AA program that we had that bridged this gap between a line holder and a reserve with open time. One of the things with an availability flight attendant, all open time was first come, first serve, and they were able to tap into it. Line holders were not able to access open time to pick it up until the day before the trip. So think of it kind of like UBL. They were only able to get something on UBL. There was no TTS. So availability in today's world that we have with how TTS works with seniority, and you are able to access that so far out in advance, availability is not on the table for us either.
Thanks, Kelly. You said it well. The survey with the A-Days, that was not the last survey. It was the survey prior to that survey because it was such a low turnout for that survey. That's why it was not added to this last survey. And as far as availability, I think one of the things we have today also is today you are a reserve for that 1 month, but then you're a line holder, line holder, line holder with protections. And if we even entertain something like availability, most likely there would be a percentage of our flight attendants that would never be a line holder. They would go from reserve to availability, 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 and then another reserve. So I think, you know, we've kind of realize that's not going to work. The other chatter we hear a lot is what about straight reserve, right? We want to go back to straight reserve. We definitely hear that quite a bit. So we did survey that. That was in our last survey. The results of that survey showed us that that would not be, if we went to that, that tentative agreement would not pass with that in it, with just straight reserve. So we are looking at other options, but, and maybe, I'm sure you probably have heard this, more years of straight reserve with a backstop of rotation. That means that, you know, there might be a few more years of straight to lower the seniority of reserve so that we can get those on 30 years off of reserve. But there always would be the backstop of rotation so that you would not be, you know, like the others, the old straight reserve system or the straight reserve that we see at other airlines where they're just on straight reserve until they're. So we just kind of wanted to really mention A-Days, this straight reserve with no backstop of rotation. We wanted to kind of put that out there right away so everybody knows where we're at as far as the negotiating team. I think Joe said it really well. This is really, it is very difficult. We wish there was a magic answer out there that would just, you know, take care of it, meaning you don't need reserves because nobody wants to be on reserve. But, you know, we are doing everything we can. We probably will be doing some more polls or surveys to try and get a little more fine-tuned on this. We do want to talk to you about the improvements that we are talking about and that we're proposing for the reserve system, because that's part of this is what we've heard, especially when we do talk about, let's say, adding on more years of straight, is everybody's like, oh, I don't want to do that because this reserve system is too hard for somebody to be on straight reserve, you know, for more than what we already are. So we hear that. We hear you on that. It definitely, we need to make some changes to the reserve system that we currently have to make it a better system for the flight attendants that sit up. So I think Reese and Tim are going to talk about some of those items that we are going to be proposing.
So yeah, so we definitely have heard from a lot of reserves about the need for improvements to reserves, both for flexibility for the time that they're on reserve as well as for their time off. One of the major things is that people who want to fly want to be able to fly. We don't. To that end, we have proposed giving clicks for any trips that are flown. It all basically is a time balancing system so that, you know, you don't have a group of people that's stuck at the bottom getting used over and over and over. So in the proposal, any time that you go to work, you'll be getting a click for the amount of days of the trip. On your reserve days, correct. And we've also proposed that, you know, if it's a turn that turns into a 2 or 3 day, the clicks would follow whatever the trip is. So if it's 3 day, it goes down to a 1 day, then you'd end up with the one click because that's what you actually feel. This allows people who are raising their hand to fly to actually and get something for flying, right? They won't be the ones first to be involuntarily assigned. Then also for the time off, we've proposed greater access to, or actually proposed access to open time. Whereas currently you can only pick up from ETB on your days off, or if you're lucky enough that you're out of reserves, you might be able to pick up on your flex days, bowling days, but that is extremely limited. So we'd like to have the ability to pick up at your seniority on TTS, UBL on those flex days, bowling.
And to protect your ability to pick up on your flex days, we are also going to be limiting how often the company can fly you into them. We haven't totally worked out exactly what that'll look like, but it's the idea that it'll be one and done. Once you're flown into a flex day, the other ones become golden days, for example, and now they can't fly you into those any longer. And along with that, if you have a trip that you picked up from ETB on your flex day, and then the company has to assign you to it, the hours that you picked up are just taken off and you don't get any pay protection for it. We're also proposing that you'd be pay protected for those lost hours. And then also related to this kind of is protection for reserves to line holders at the end of the month. So that transition period where currently, if you have a trip in your line holder month at the beginning of the next month, and you have reserves days before that, the company has not been putting you on a trip that would take you off of your line holder trip because then they have to pay protect you for it. What they're doing now is for anyone who is a line holder that has days off at the beginning of the following month, they're assigning you that trip and then taking away your days off. We are proposing that seniority should rule here. So if you were senior enough in your line holder month to hold those days off for whatever reason, your days off should be protected. So instead of it being whoever has days off gets used first, now it's just gonna be whoever is the most junior or the most junior in inverse seniority order would get the trip. And so you may have days off, but you were junior, that's okay. You may have a trip, but at least, and you might be assigned into it, but at least you would get pay protected now. So that's something that would also help give more pay protections to reserve and just more protection in general for the reserve system that we have. We're also proposing for 3 wraps instead of 4. In general, what we've seen is that, for example, if you have 100 reserves that day, if you have 4 wraps, you only have 25 reserves per wrap. But if you have 3 wraps, you could have 33.
So that increases the amount of reserves that are in each rep and enables better use of the reserves that we have instead of having to split them up into different reps.
There's a few other improvements that you'll see also in the opening proposal, which will be on the website as well.
And just like Julie talked about at the beginning of this, all of this is in the opening proposal, and we do encourage you to go back and read what we have proposed. And if you see something that you need more information on or you have additional suggestions, then you can reach out and email us. But start there so that you can figure out and learn more about what our proposal on the reserve section is going to be.
Another thing that we didn't mention, which is I think big for a lot of people, is that once you've maxed out, right, then you'd be treated as a line holder. Currently today, once you're maxed out, it's pretty much limited to ATP. We feel that once you're maxed out, you should be treated as a line holder, just like everyone else. So that is something we're proposing, as well as the ability to be released. Duty, if they say they don't need you for reserve, you'll be able to call up and say, hey, release me, and then cut you free. So those are two in addition.
Perfect, thank you. And I know reserve transparency is always something we've been hearing since FOI. Back in 2018, and I will say we're making some headway on it. I know a lot of our flight attendants have used an app that has been very successful in giving them that transparency. We are definitely having a lot of discussions to try and make sure that we continue that for you. We understand how important that is for all. Okay, so let's move on to some of the questions, and we'll go a little longer than the 1 hour because we did have a late start, so I don't want people worried that we're not going to get to the questions. So Joe, I've got two questions for you right off the bat. The first question is, we are seeing inflation rates hit their worst over a 40-year period. This year alone, every day, goods have seen around a 10% increase, not including oil prices. What type of plan is in place to raise pay rates to match these historic numbers? So I guess.
That's too long.
Joe, you may be on mute. This is the story of our lives, right? With teens. You want to text him?
Yeah, let's just continue.
Okay, so we're going to skip over the first two questions that Joe's going to answer, and we will get back to those as soon as we hear Joe back on. Okay, let's see here. Okay, this question, and we still do hear from Legacy American and Legacy US Air, and it seems like, you know, this contract, we have people who want to kind of bring back something they may have had in a previous contract. So you'll hear that through some of these questions. But we have with US Air, we got paid one flight hour for every 3 hours on duty. So that took care of boarding pay and sitting around time. If you're away for 60 hours, you got paid 20 hours. Why can't we go back to something like that? I think Reese, you're going to help us with that.
Yes. So currently there are three ways that you get paid today. You get actual flight pay or the duty period minimum, which is that 5 hour per duty period that you're probably familiar with. You get trip reg, which is 1 hour of flight pay for every 3.5 hours that you're away from home, or you get duty break, which is 1 hour of flight pay for every 2 hours that you're on duty. And at the end of the trip, you're paid the highest of those breaks. So the math is done, and whichever one pays you highest is the one you end up with the pay. So on a trip where you may have a lot of flying or long flights, most often that will be flight pay. On a trip where you might have short flights or not very many flights, but you have maybe long layovers, that most likely will pay highest with the trip reg. And on a trip where you might have a lot of sits or you might end up with a lot of delays, that most likely will pay highest with duty reg. So your HI3 actually does a really good job of calculating the totals out. So for example, at the bottom of your HI3, there's a box that says, or a line that says TAFB. TAFB stands for time away from base, and that is the amount of time that you're away from base. So that number divided by 3.5 would be your trip rate. And if that number is higher than the time you were flying or the time you were on duty, that's the number that you'll end up getting paid. So take a look at that if you ever have questions. how you're getting paid, because that it's really, it's explained really well on your HI3, and it's pretty easy to read once you know what to look for. And just keep in mind that the HI3, it has decimal points, but it's actually time math. So first number will be the hour, then it'll be a decimal point, and the second number will be minutes, not actually out of 100 like a normal decimal point. So just make sure you use a time calculator if you're trying to figure that out. But more importantly, how this all relates to negotiations is that we are asking for better rigs in each of these areas. That will come up in section 11, which is hours of service. So we haven't passed that yet, but it is going to be one of the sections that we will be passing soon. And what that means is, for example, today, a three duty period trip, which with between all of the rigs, the highest that it gets paid in this example could be 15 hours, which is that 5 hour per duty period pay. In the next contract, if we, for example, ask for 5 hours and 15 minutes per duty period, that same trip that pays today just 15 hours could pay 15 hours and 45 minutes in the through the next contract. So that's something that we're hoping for, and we will have all those numbers and figures once we complete our proposal for Section 11 hours of service.
And part of Section 11, we are proposing sit time pay.
Yes.
Right? Because I think she mentioned sit time, and that's, we heard a lot about sit time in the last 2 years, that's for sure. It doesn't seem to be getting any better. And that's something that I know our base presidents are constantly harping on the company about, the sit time has to decrease. But we are proposing the sit time pay, and then I also see boarding, and we do have boarding pay also if you're looking to compensation. Great, thanks, Reese. Okay, I think we have Joe back on. Joe, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Good. Okay, so I'm going to repeat the first question for you. We are seeing inflation rates hit their worst over a 40-year period. This is true. This year alone, every day, goods have seen around a 10% increase, not including oil prices. What type of plan is in place to raise pay rates to match these historic numbers?
Yeah, so in our bullet point opener, we did not specify the exact wage rates we would be proposing, because we don't want to be locked in at this point in time. We will be getting to compensation once we work through all of the other sections. And at that point, we would develop a full compensation proposal. And when we develop a compensation proposal, we look at a variety of factors. And one of the big factors we're going to look at is the extraordinary inflation that's going on right now. And just to keep up with inflation, we would need healthy wage increases. So, you know, obviously that's going to probably set us up on a course with the company. But clearly, we're going to need to, you know, have a wage proposal that reflects the reality that people are facing, which is everything.
Thanks, Joe. Okay, one more while we have you here. Why did we top out at, it says 14 years, but it's 13 years. I have been flying 37 years and make the same as someone flying 13 years. We no longer have to quit if we get married or have children. Please get back to me on these questions. Are we flying through the town hall? Well, we already answered that. You can watch the video. So can you explain how our pay scale works as far as why we it used to be 15 years when we topped out. Now it's 13 years, which was an improvement. So do you want to talk about that a little bit, Joe?
Yeah, so we have a pay system that, you know, has steps that, you know, your rate increases throughout the course of the pay scale. One of the issues we face is, you know, on the one hand, we want to represent and recognize longevity. But on the other hand, we don't want to let management to underpay people. So in some of the regional contracts, it takes 25, 30 years to get to the top of the pay scale. And what that means is that, you know, relatively fewer of the flight attendants are able to, you know, enjoy the top of the scale. So I think it's somewhat of a balancing act. We haven't got to the pay scale in particular. But in general, when you extend the pay scale and make people, you know, wait longer to get to the top of the pay scale, that means that the company will save money. you know, so, but on the other hand, you know, I think, well, you know, there's a, also a concern with, recognizing longevity. So I think when the committee puts together a proposal, we'll just have to take a look at it.
Thanks, Joe. Okay, next is another compensation question. Is financial compensation being negotiated when the company violates provisions of our contract? If so, which areas and how fast will these be resolved? Susan, I think you're going to help us with that.
Yes, crew schedule error is currently addressed in two places in our contract, and we know that this language does not go far enough to protect our line holders and reserves. So we're looking to expand that specifically for crew schedule error, which currently only is for after sequence origination. We want that to include before the sequences as well. Rescheduling outside of the footprint of the trip happens a lot, and we're looking for 150% error pay when you are rescheduled beyond the footprint of your trip. And another big area of violation lately are hotels, right? We see in these IROPS or rescheduling situations where flight attendants wait forever for a hotel room. So we are proposing language that if you don't have a confirmed hotel within 30 minutes of your reschedule or cancellation or other scheduling issue, the entire sequence will be paid at 150%.
Thanks, Susan. Okay, next is, was there ever a proposal for additional pay for trips that fly during the night? And I think, Tim, you're going to answer.
The answer is yes. We are proposing this. This is something that we had back in 2001 for about a minute around the LA side, but we lost it very quickly. I don't think it was ever implemented, actually. But it is something other airlines have, and it is something that is in our compensation proposal, along with many other forms of additional compensation, compensation section, which is found on the website.
Thanks, Tim. Okay, how is per diem calculated? It would be beneficial to the company to pay a substantial amount of per diem. Flight attendants spend most of their lives out from their homes. Isn't that the truth? Okay, Reese, I think you're going to help us with that.
Yes, so per diem is actually covered currently in Section 4 expenses. So also through the opener, you'll be able to see that it's covered there as well. Currently, the rate is for domestic $2.20 per hour. For international, it's $2.50 per hour. And again, it just comes down to how much that TAFB or time away from base was. Whatever that number ends up being when you're released from your trip, you just multiply that by 220 if it was a purely domestic trip, or if there was a mix of domestic and international, it's a little more complicated because you'd have to do each segment by the particular number. If it was a purely international trip, though, again, it would just be that 250. And as discussed a few times already, this is a number amount, so it will be decided at the end with economics, but it is a proposal that we are asking for an increase here.
We definitely will be looking for an increase. I think when we talk about inflation,
like, yes,
everything is going up today. So this is something that, you know, when you think about when this was negotiated back in 2014, here we are in 2022, $2.20 an hour is minimum. So thanks for that, Reese. Okay. Hoping the negotiating team is working on getting a sizable increase in our company match. I believe they're talking about our 401k. Susan, do you want to answer that?
Yes, most definitely. We'll be looking for an increase not only in the company match, but the company contribution as well.
Okay, next, can we try to get paid for boarding? I think I've seen a lot about this lately. I think there's even a petition out there for that. And isn't Biz Hero a violation of our contract? Tim, you want to take those on?
Sure. So, yes, boarding, additional pay for or additional compensation for boarding is something we're looking at. As Reese already covered, everyone knows we are paid minimum of 1 minute of flight pay for every 2 minutes on duty. So basically, all of us, when we go to work, no matter where we're going, we're guaranteed half of our hourly flight pay for every minute from sign in till the end of your duty. However, that said, we fully recognize that boarding is one of the most, if not the most, difficult parts of our job, right? And some of us board two flights, three flights, four flights, a duty period. So we'd like to get something additionally for flight attendants in that area. As you know, pilots follow the same structure that we do. They do their walk around before every flight, the same way we do, 1 minute flight pay for every 2 minutes on duty. So this is something that would be pretty much new in the industry. So it is going to be, it's most likely going to be pushed back, but we are definitely pushing for this. And the second part of the question was, is HERO a violation of our contract? So to be clear, Biz Hero is a company product, company tool that they put out for flight attendants to use. It does not have the support of the APFA. There are numerous issues with Biz Hero, and there's a few things the flight attendants need to know when using it, namely that the hotels that Biz Hero is using are not necessarily APFA compliant hotels. They're not hotels that have been submitted to APFA for review, jointly agreed to. You could be split up from the rest of your crew. You would be kicked out of your hotel room in the morning when you have a late departure. Show up. We've had reports where flight attendants are showing up to the hotel they've booked and there's no room, or they're demanding a credit card. So there are issues with that app. Is it technically a violation of our contract? To be perfectly clear, the company's responsibility is to secure our accommodations, period. That's their job. We do have some contractual language that provides for instances where they have not selected a hotel for you or not provided that accommodation. You could go out on your own, use your credit card, and submit for reimbursement. But again, that ultimate responsibility is the company. So is it a violation to use the app? Not necessarily. However, we would advise probably against it. But again, it's up to the individual flight attendant. If you're faced with sitting on hold for 4 hours, I can see how someone might want to use it. But to remind everyone, until you get your hotel room, you are still on duty. So that duty rig is still running until they get you a hotel and you are at your labor. So that's important to remember.
So I think I've asked Larry to be here today, especially because Larry's our vice president, and Margo, and because we have filed a grievance that includes Biz Hero in it. And I think we can talk about that a little bit right now, Larry, as far as with the grievance that was filed about it, and also what we've been doing, right, for the past, I feel like it's been forever, but for the past year and a half, since we've had so many of these hotel situations that are completely unacceptable. I mean, we need our rest. We need, when we get to our layover, for us to have a hotel room. The fact that Biz Hero has become such a widely known and used product here is not right, right? Considering it is supposed to be, at least initially, I believe it was for only once in a while when, you know, there was huge IROPS or something. But it seems like it was open last weekend and there is an IROP somewhere, I don't know where. I think, Larry, do you want to talk about the grievance a little bit and then also a little bit about Biz Hero?
Yeah, we filed the grievance last summer. And since then, we address each time we have these epic failures to accommodate our crews during IROPS. And we bring these concerns to the company, and this is all part of the process. I know it seems to take forever, but this is part of our process that we work through, attempting to reach a settlement with the company prior to an arbitration. So we continue with that process, along with the many other grievances that our department handles. But we know this is an important topic for our members, and we are getting close to scheduling this grievance for arbitration if we can't reach a settlement with the company.
And we did just talk, I think it was a week ago, with our new CEO about the issues that we saw with the event I believe it was February, and that Florida event. That seems like it had to be March on, but had a lot of really egregious situations that happened with our flight attendants as far as
not getting hotel rooms, sleeping in the lobby of a hotel, flight attendants sharing hotels. It's something that is, I feel like it's Groundhog's Day, that it's like we're constantly back here, and the company keeps saying to us, they are going to fix this, and it's still not fixed. So we definitely, the grievance, also the pilots filed the grievance at the same time.
Yes.
So we've been working with them on the same issue also. Okay. All right. Moving on. Next question. Oh, okay. What is APFA doing to eliminate the hard 40? And I think Kelly's going to take this one.
That's a light question. So one of the things that we're looking at is it's on our opener proposal, is that we want to reduce the hard 40 outside of PBS. So when you're utilizing the additional scheduling systems like TTS, UBL, ETB, that you would be able to go below 40 on that. So that's what we're looking to do to hit that.
And we got to that because of the survey, right? This was a question on our survey. We did take a look at the results of our survey, and really the results showed us that the majority of the flight attendants, the issue with the 40 is that they feel it's less flexibility, right? Meaning less flexibility as far as being able to drop down. They want to drop down, and then a lot of them said they could go back up, but it was just that dropping below 40. So so that is the proposal. As this has been a subject for a very long time, and the subject has been debated and discussed for probably many, many years, and always with getting rid of the 40 was an employment threshold. And that is something that we talked about here as far as a negotiating team, that the board has talked about, that, you know, we've been out there actually in the membership also, and we do not want to add an employment threshold to our contract, because once we have that employment threshold in there, right, it's very hard for us to, you would not be able to get your job back. So an employment threshold is not something we ever want to see in a contract. So thank you for answering that. And we'll move on to the next question. Okay, is there any discussion regarding cashing out unused sick hours each year instead of people calling in sick and driving the reserve numbers up? This flight attendant has over 1,000 hours of sick time. And I think, Tim, you're going to take that.
Yeah, so yes, we'd love to see sick time paid out at a higher rate. As you know, I think we're getting a little more $8 an hour on retirement. So we'd obviously like to see an increase to that. 1,000 hours of sick time, you're talking $68,250. That's a lot of money to take if you retire with that. And we're getting $8 an hour. The other option we've talked about also that we're still discussing with sick as well as patients, is the ability to convert those, the amount of money that you'd have into some sort of retirement health account. So that is something we're still discussing internally. Do plan to make a proposal on.
Thanks, Tim. Okay, next, are we doing anything to reintroduce sick makeup? So many of us need to be able to build up our sick banks. Kelly, want to take that one?
Yes, ma'am. So we have proposed to put forth a sick makeup program. And what that is, that actually was a legacy AA program that we had. And it allowed you to go into open time, pick up a trip. You would not get paid the flight hours for that trip in the month in which you flew. Those hours would be placed in your sick bank. All the other pays associated with that sequence, such as night pay, boarding pay, those types of things, you would go ahead and get those in the month that you did the flying. But those hours would go in your sick bank. So we are looking at that. Something else I'm going to tag onto this, and I know you didn't ask, but I'm going to throw it in there anyway. We're also asking for a rapid reaccrual for sick time. So what that means is if you go out on a long-term event, injury, illness, pregnancy, something like that. Once you go into an unpaid status, you use the sick bank while you were out, and now you're going into unpaid. So you're not really unpaid, just using your sick time. So now you've come back. All of your sick bank that you used while you were on that event, you would be able to rapidly reaccrue it upon your return. What that means is that you would earn 10 hours of sick time for every month after you return that you were eligible to earn. And that would be replaced in your sick bank up until you've reached that total bank that you use for that event. Another thing, I noticed that you said the IOD on there. I think this is really important. One of the things that we have proposed in IOD, and it is that moment that we're going to have with the company on fighting, is they auto-designate your FMLA for an IOD event. We want to have that removed. We want it to be where a flight attendant is the one who decides, I want to apply for FMLA for this, and I want to use FMLA for this. That's everything on that.
And Kelly, I think you did say this. I'm not sure. We already did propose this, and the company already came back and said they're not interested.
No, we're going to end
up getting it. Yeah, this is going to be a tabled section.
It's tabled.
It's already been tabled, but it's they... You know, as if you go to the website, you'll see the response that we get from the company after we propose these items that are here to make your life better. So we want you to, you know, make sure you see that side of it, right? Because that's kind of the good part of this type of transparency with negotiations. You can see what the company is. Thanks, Kelly. Okay, we're going to move on to vacation. Are you working on equalizing the payout for vacation hours? 6 or less days of vacation should be paid the same rate as 7 or more days of pay. Vacation time is vacation time. Please get this corrected. Okay, Wendy, I think you're going to talk about this, and then we're going to also display a chart of what we are. Oh, it's already up there, I think. Of what we are proposing.
Yes, so we are looking at having all vacation days, be it filler or a vacation day, be at the same rate. We're asking for 5 hours. Currently, so that is also an increase to our vacation rate. The chart that's up on the board is showing how we compare to other airlines in days accrued and our current rate per hour for each of those days. So as you can see, American on the lower end of the years 1 through 4 and all the way through 9, we really are behind the other airlines in how many days accrue. So we are looking to increase those days across the board. If you want to go to the next slide, Josh. So the chart is showing years of active service and how many days per year we're proposing. And then if you look at the chart on the right, it's a breakdown of the proposed years, proposed days, proposed hours. And then that column says proposed total current days times proposed hours. It's showing you today what you would get if we had 5 hours, how many hours your vacation is worth in total. And then the next column over is proposed total days times proposed hours. So here's where we would increase to if we got the proposed days and the proposed hours, how many hours your vacation would be worth in the end. So from every year. And so yes, we are seeking increases to vacation accrual, pay, and to make all days the same, whether it's 1 day or 7 days or 42 days in a row, you will get the same rate of pay. Okay, thanks, Wendy.
Okay, and that's in our hotline today also, I think.
Yes.
We mentioned our vacation. All right. So if you're not signed up for the hotline, make sure you get signed up, okay? There's a lot of information that comes out in the hotline. Next question. What is the company's hang up with the restrictive and draconian speaker rules? Why do they insist on such a long lock-in? And Brian, I think.
We absolutely agree with you on the concern about the number of years of the lock-in. If you refer to our negotiations update number 8 that came out in January, on January 26th, we discuss many of our proposal items that we put out for speaker, this one in particular. We did ask the company, we posted a significant reduction from 10 years to 5. The company balked at that. Their intent was to maintain their 10 years across the board. We have passed a secondary proposal back to them that does increase that from 5 to 7, but that's what we are holding at this point. We do agree and understand that 10 years is a very long time. And, you know, to your statement of draconian, you know, we're trying to enhance your lives and make your work life a much more compatible to your home life. So in reducing this is something that we're definitely looking at doing. So
thanks, Brian. Okay, another speaker question. Please assign speakers to certain positions to release the other assignments to non-speakers. Do not increase speaker positions. Tim, I think you're going to take that.
Yeah, so we've gotten a lot of feedback, both foreign language speakers as well as non-speakers, and from both respective legacies as to foreign language speaker program. Many of the emails were about reducing the number of speakers on board, increase this number of speakers on board, keep the speakers the same. We have not gone in the direction of reducing any headcount for speakers on the aircraft from the current. So I know there's some misinformation going around that we're reducing the speakers to 1 per aircraft. That is not at all accurate. There's no change to the number of speakers per flight from the current practice today. What was proposed and agreed to was changing where the speakers had to be on board. Currently, their placement is determined by cabin, with up to 1 in one cabin, up to 2 in another cabin. That is supposed to change to per aircraft, which means you'll be using your seniority to determine what position you're filling on board the aircraft. And if, say, a crew of 10 had 1 through 7 that were non-speakers and they've filled up 1 through 7, then 8, 9, and 10 would therefore have to be a speaker. We did get some concern about if this would push speakers to 1 cabin. That could happen, but it's not certainly mean that the speakers will all be in 1 cabin. They could be in separate cabins, they could be in the same cabin, or as we see today, there could be no speakers at all. The numbers that are in the contract are the maximum numbers for speakers. So that is a change that was proposed and agreed to. I think that's just that.
Okay. Next question is another speaker question. Is it true the AAA is reducing the speakers to just 1 per flight? Kind of Tim's answered that, but we'll expand a little. And also, the speakers cannot bid on premium cabins. Reese?
So just again, throwing it back to the website and being able to look at everything that we've done, speaker or foreign language speaker is a TA section. So you'll be able to see that under our tentative agreement portion. And it does indicate that you can have up to 2 per flight under 200 seats and up to 3 per flight on aircraft that have 200 or more seats. So that is no change today as far as the number of speakers on board the aircraft. And of course, kind of like Tim said, you'll be using your seniority to bid. So you'll be able to bid for any position in the cabin, except of course, just like today, galley.
Thanks, Reese. Okay, next question. We're gonna move on a little bit to, looks like this is PBS. At United, their monthly bids close in the morning and they have results by the same day in the afternoon. Why can't we get ours faster? Okay, well, it's pretty simple as far as United is still in line bid. That means their lines are already pre-built. They run it, they run the bid and it awards by seniority. End of story, we're done. With PBS, much different, right? When we all put our bids in, we all have specific and generic bids in PBS. And so the run for certain bases may take an hour or 2. But what happens is they do multiple runs for every base to make sure we can get the highest satisfaction for our flight attendants with PBS. And some people go, well, how can that be? Because I put in all specific, right? It's not the specific that changes, it's the generic that changes. So if I put in my first layer, I'll take any IPD and I'll take any Monday through Friday
There are multiple options that I could be awarded in my first layer to satisfy. So it is going to take longer, and a lot of that is because our bidding is so entirely different than United's, right, in a line bidding world. We are, PBS kind of tailors to the days off I want, right, tailors the type of trip I want. I can even do IPD in part of the month, the domestic in another part of the month. So it's definitely a lot different than for those that were here during line bidding days. We did the same trip usually the whole month long, right, and it was already built on the day. So you didn't have any way that you wanted to tailor your line to what you needed would be done after the bidding process, not during the bidding process. Today, because we do that during the bidding process, it takes longer for those bids to be done. So I don't see that getting any shorter, quite honestly. We're really in tune to how the process works. And if we did shorten the time frame that it took to do this, the satisfaction level for our flight attendants would not be. Okay, next up is, are we addressing the issue of ETB and the abuse of seniority? ETB should only be available for trip needs. All drops and pickups should be through TTS so that seniority is on. So we're really aware of the issues that we have. I believe this is the cartel issue that this flight attendant is speaking of. And this is something that the company is addressing. I know it's not happening fast enough for everyone. You know, you probably have read our hotline that we put out to everyone, also discussing the situation where you should only be bidding for trips that you are planning to fly, not bidding for trips that you're going to give away to other flight attendants. So making changes to ETB and how ETB processes and how TTS processes is something that we are taking a very good look at. If there are changes that we want to make, that will help to curtail some of the cartel activity. We will probably have polls. We're working on that right now, right, Josh? So that we can not necessarily just have to do surveys on this, but polls on it also, so that we can kind of fine tune what we do if we make any changes in this area. But we're aware that this is an issue, and it is definitely something that we're looking at making some changes to how some of this is processed so that we can curb the cartel activity.
And any changes that we make to this current systems would membership ratification.
Absolutely. That would be a major change to our contract. So I would take the ratification by the membership. So this will be done in negotiations. And hopefully polls will be on our website coming very soon. Josh and Todd, can you give us an idea of when?
We're hoping in the next week and a half there's an issue with one of our third-party vendors that we're looking.
We've been trying because we really think this will really help, you know, the negotiating, you know, and these type of things. So thank you for the question. Okay, this is kind of goes along with that same thing. If they're asking if we're addressing the issue of red flag trips being dropped and or sold by the same person picking up another trip in red flag for the same days. So we're aware that we have flight attendants who pick up a trip and that's a red flag or UBL trip. They go ahead and they drop it to another flight attendant, then they go back in, use their seniority to pick up another trip. This is definitely something we're discussing a solution to this problem. So thank you for sending in the question. We will definitely be discussing with the company a solution to this. Okay. All right, Larry, I might need you a little help on these two. So the next two questions are about staffing. The first one is, are we going to get back position 12 and 13 on the 777-300 or not? Because I have worked both position 5 and 4 to London, and it becomes physically impossible to maintain a smooth service with a quality service. Customers are noticing it and complaining too. And then the next one is, our flights are full, service is back to normal. Yes, it is as of the 18th, right? Alcohol is back. When will we be bringing back staffing? If staffing is not coming back, what type of compensation will we receive? And the new 787-9 will be flying as expanded business class and premium economy sections. Will we receive extra staffing to work this aircraft? So, staffing.
So,
went away 2 years ago in 2020, right? The company changed.
Yes.
Our staffing in 2020.
Yep.
We filed a grievance back then on it. We tried, along with our base presidents, to get a snapback because they did this in the height of COVID. And of course, we didn't have service. We also didn't have passengers on our aircraft at that time. So we met with the highest level of the company at that time, and we said, we didn't agree to this. I want to make sure everybody understands we did not agree to cutting our staffing ever. We also wanted the snap. They did not agree to that. They would not agree to a snapback, meaning when the passengers came back, when the service came back. So we filed a grievance. So Larry, I'll let you take it from there.
Since then, we continue on a regular basis, even at our high-level labor management meeting, to bring this up as high as at the time it was Doug. But we continue to bring this up with at the highest levels with Robert Isom, especially now because the company, you know, they're all talking about reliability and running a, you know, a consistent service and schedule, et cetera. However, it's at the expense of our flight attendants and our passengers. And we know this is a big topic for many of you, especially, you know, those of you that fly, as noted in the question there, on these international markets where, you know, you definitely see a notice because of the staffing changes, particularly in our premium cabins. So we continue to address this with the company. And we've had numerous discussions trying to get to a settlement. As Julie just said, it was never our understanding that the staffing would stay permanent, that we understood during COVID and when our loads were considerably down, you know, the need for the staffing change. So we continue as at national level, as well as the SBA department, and working with Margo to proceed forward with this arbitration. I will say we've become very frustrated with the slow process. Yes, COVID slowed down the process. We weren't able to do arbitrations on a regular basis because of COVID. But now that, you know, many of the COVID, if not all the COVID restrictions are lifted, we're trying to catch up and get through all these arbitrations, all these grievances, including many of them past grievances. But we know that this is a key and important one. There is much preparation to be done for this arbitration. So that's kind of the process. And I know everyone is looking for an immediate fix. And, you know, we're working towards that and scheduling the arbitration. But the company has made it crystal clear to answer the question, no, they are not bringing back the staffing. They continue to claim that we are industry competitive, but they're not willing to, you know, to make a change to the staffing.
And what's different is we have first class, right?
We're
comparing ourselves to United and Delta. They no longer have first class. They have a business class and a coach cabin, a main cabin. And so to compare us to the United and Delta right now, it's not an equal comparison because they do not have a first class service. That is where especially we see it with the 777-300 and with the 321T, where we have the biggest issues with the cut in our staffing is on that plane in first, on those aircraft in first class.
And to answer the question about the new configuration for the new 787-9s that will be delivered, I think it's next year. We brought that up with the company, and we, you know, we asked, what's the staffing going to be on that aircraft? Because with the increase in the premium cabin now, we expect the staffing to be, you know, adjusted accordingly. They had no information for us. Again, that was kind of the leaked communication that got sent out in the media, got a hold of that. So we're hoping to get more specifics on what the cabin will look like and what the company's plan is for staffing.
And as far as the contract is concerned with staffing, the language in our contract today, basically we have to be notified of any staffing changes 45 days out of the change, and then we can grieve it. That's what the language is we have today in our contract. We don't have a staffing table that says this is what you must have. So we are doing what our contract says today. And as far as making changes to that, you know, we can look at that, but it's going to be, staffing is a very difficult issue to be able to add in, right? If we already had it, it's a different story, but to add it in.
And Julie, if I can just add, we talked about it at the beginning about proposed changes to 30 and 31. And those are really key sections of our contract, especially in situations like this where we have a presidential grievance that we want to, you know, we're challenging a decision by the company. Our current contractual language, the company's not following, you know, and again, I get COVID delayed the process, but that is why we are really, we really want to make some key changes to 3031 to speed up this process so that we're not waiting years to get to these arbitrations, right, to get a decision. That, you know, we have, the company is notorious, I tell you, for delaying this process and wanting to, you know, delay us scheduling an arbitration or locking in arbitration dates. And so that's something that we're definitely working toward. Right now, we're kind of at a stalemate, to say the least. So it's going to take some work, yeah. But know that we are working on making, because that's the only way we're going to make changes to get things done, is when the company knows that they have an arbitration date looming, that's when they tend to begin to settle and try to work with us.
Thank you, Larry. Okay, we're moving along because we've got a lot more questions and I know we're already well past our time, so we'll keep going here a little longer. Are you attempting to negotiate inter-base trades mirroring the pilot's scheduled contractual rights? I think, Kelly, you're going to answer that.
I am. So out of baseline, hot topic. A lot of airlines have it. United has it, Delta has it, Southwest has it. Our membership wants it. So what we did with that task is we had to go back and go to the contract and look and see how open time is processed. And when we look at that, we had to kind of like reimagine it to figure out where this out of base flying would come in. So what we decided to do was, once the base has had an opportunity for that flying, and when I say the base, I mean all the line holders as well as the aggressive reserves. Because they have some, they're in that base. They should have that opportunity at their own flying first. Once all that has been processed, then at that point, there could be an opportunity for out-of-base flying on UDL.
Kelly. Okay. This is a question that I answered at the start, but I'm going to just read a little bit of it, because I don't want this person to think we didn't notice that. Why give us less than 5 days of notice that you're having this virtual town? Totally unacceptable. I can tell you, would have loved to have given you more notice than that. But today, with technology that we have today, we can have you submit questions in advance. We can record these sessions, put them on our website. So like I said, it's not like the past where you had to be off on this day at this time to watch this town hall. Today, you can catch it tonight if you were flying. I apologize. We, of course, would love to give you more than 5 days notice. And we will try and do that for the next town hall. But we really knew we had a short window here to get this town hall in, because we are meeting with the company again next week in negotiations. And we needed to connect with the membership now. So apologize, but I hope that you appreciate the technology we have, that we can, you can still be able to hear everything that's being said. Okay, next up is, this is about the commuter policy. Okay, are there any discussions about making the commuter policy better, with the company allowing no fees for customers to change their flight and get revenue standby? It has made it so difficult to commute. Does the company not want the flight attendant to get to work? Unfortunately, where I commute from has been so challenging this year, I leave the day before. Kelly, you want to take that one on?
I will. I'm a commuter too, and boy, it sucks lately. So what we're looking at on that is a couple things. The commuter policy, and let's talk about the jump seat policy as well, because I'm not sure where you commute from, but that's a big piece of it. So one of the things that we have proposed, and this is a tabled section, so these are the places where we have hit up and we're at stalemate until we get down the line a little bit farther. So we want to remove the weight restriction on the jump seat. So that won't be an issue. Also, we want to include inoperative jump seats in the policy, which currently is not there. And that's for the jump seat part. So as far as we go into the commuting policy, one of the things that we're looking at is at the point of check-in, which is 24 hours prior to your flight or below, as long as you would have a seat within your priority, so if you used to D1, D2, and you would have had a boarding pass, and then something happens, you would be covered. American wants that to be a load factor less than 80%. Do we have a flight that has a load factor less than 80%? Not any that I'm commuting on. Which then leads me to the other airlines, because apparently they have four seats available. We want to include other airlines in our commuter policy, where that if you've got your boarding pass and you can show that, hey, there were seats available at some point, you know, relative to when you were going to travel, as long as you can substantiate that would be covered under the commuter policy. So those are the improvements that we're choosing to seek at this time.
And we have proposed those. The company has come back,
right?
And so you can go to that section, that's 37 in general, and you can see exactly what we propose and what the company's response has been. Okay, has APFA been involved with making sure that we have adequate crew rest areas for the 321 XLR? Get into the rest. Yes, we definitely have been involved in the process. Our contract and scheduling chair just had a visit to actually be able to check out, it's called the crouton, and it is for the 321 XLR, it will be three seats on each side. It's the last row. And there will be a built-in, it's kind of like a footrest, but it actually comes up so that it's flat and it turns the three seats like into a bed. And then you will have a padded comforter that will go on top of that so that you don't feel the seatbelts below. And Marty and Jeff, who are contract and scheduling chair, just went and visited the facility, and they were very happy with what they, they're going to kill me for saying that, because if anybody has complaints, they're going to go back to them. But we have been involved for the type of aircraft it is. Obviously, bunks aren't an option. So it is, we looked at, I believe it was Air New Zealand that had a very similar type seat, and they called it a sky lounge, I think it was, something like that.
And of course, we proposed reserving a business class seat.
Yes, thanks,
Larry. For our crew rest, but like the pilots have, but unfortunately, you know, the company wasn't willing.
So this two flight attendants at the most would be on rest on this aircraft anyhow, because of the number of flight attendants, and so they would have a whole row to lay down on, and it would be more of like a bed. You have the option to just pull up two of the seats, and you could have the last one down if you still wanted to sit there. Also, so it is a good option.
And it'll be heavily curtained off.
And curtained off, yes. Yeah. Okay, can we please cover parking costs for all airports at full rate, including co-terminal and satellite bases also? Brian.
Yes, we are very concerned about this parking, especially for all of us, not just our commuters. We're working to enhance the satellite parking issues. Currently, there is an outstanding grievance that is scheduled to be heard in June at the next quarterly system board that will discuss a specific satellite parking situation that we're dealing with. Utilizing some of the information that we pull from that will help us enhance our movement going forward in regards to the parking circumstances. In addition to that, regarding the commuters, the displacements have caused a lot of our concern or issues with the parking situations that we have throughout the system. And in that, the airports themselves have reduced options for our members to park at those airports. The number consistently seems to be growing. We are looking at proposing to the company items to rectify this, to work on the cost, because the cost for parking is so dramatically across the board, as low as $18 all the way up to the realm of $400. So it's everywhere you could possibly, you know, look at. So in that aspect, we are looking at trying to balance out those costs for our commuters and in the parking situation. It is going to be a little bit of a difficult situation as the airport authorities in each of our cities have control of that, but it's something that we are working on.
Thanks, Brian. Okay, I'm going to tack on to that really quick because we have a question on here, and this is a satellite base, Sacramento. That is one of our satellites. We have about three or four that you can drive to the mother base, right? Not all satellites, you know, the majority of our satellites are a flight into the mother base. So they choose satellite parking or the mother base, right? But for the bases where we have the ability to drive to the mother base and to the satellite, that's where our language today doesn't differentiate between those types of satellites. So that is definitely something we will be addressing in negotiations and trying to improve. Okay, next up, what CBA sections have been mutually cleared and agreed to by APFA and AA? I was going to say AA, APFA, APFA and A. What sections have we already agreed to? I think 16 of them, right?
Yeah, it has been 16 of them. And again, we're going to plug the website on this. We're really, really proud of it. If you go to the website and go to the negotiation status page, you can pull that up and you can look at all the T8 sections. You can also pull up all the open and tabled sections, and you can see exactly what was agreed to and things that we're apart on.
Thanks, Kelly. Okay, this is a PBS question. Can we demand more layers? I think I've heard this. I feel my seniority is violated without enough layers to bid. Brian, you want to take that one on?
Absolutely. We are proposing an increase to the number of layers, but also when looking at the number of layers available to bid, we also have to look at the timeframes for the systems to be able to process that. Right now, as an example, currently Dallas, our largest base, is processing somewhere in the realm of 20 to 26 hours. They have their own server solely for Dallas to accomplish that. Some of our other bases, such as Charlotte and Miami, they range anywhere between 6 to 10 hours in processing. So in looking at that, we also have to take those that ideal into consideration. Right now, we get our results around on the 18th. If we go too far out on the number of layers as we do that and the processing time is extended, we could be extending the number of days before we get our results out, and which also closes the window on changing up your schedule prior to the new month.
Brian? Okay, so I think we definitely do have it in our proposal about to add more. Okay, so next two questions are kind of about what Kelly was talking about, is they want a positive space community, right? Delta has it this year, I believe Southwest had it for part of the year. The pandemic produced some positive space because of especially the changes for passengers to be able to change their flights without the change fee. The question is are we trying to add this into our contract? And what we are trying to do is improve the commuting worldwide, Kelly, the changes that she talked about. But as far as positive space, even for those airlines, it's not part of their contract. It is something that the pandemic produced. We had positive space a few times in the last couple of years because, yes, it is very important that our flight attendants get to work. But as far as what we're proposing in this contract, it's more with our commuter language as far as trying to make sure that you can use other airlines, right, and that they would also help.
Can I throw on to that?
Yeah.
Because on deadheading too, some of the things that we're looking at is being able to self-book through CCI if you want to do it, exercise a deadhead flexibility, like a waiver at the beginning or the end, things like that.
Perfect. We didn't have any deadheading questions, so I'm glad you brought that up. We definitely are trying to improve deadheading. Thank you. Okay, I'm trying to move along here. Retirement or separation from the company. Allow all unused sick time to be paid out as full flight pay or for flight attendants, same as pilots. And I think we kind of already covered that, Tim. We absolutely have that in our proposal. Okay, commission of hotel room cancellations for flight attendants. If a flight attendant cancels his or her hotel room within 12 hours, then he or she should receive a commission for doing so. Do you want to discuss what we've proposed, Tim?
Sure. Yes, we did make a proposal about, we're calling it a hotel gain share program. So that would be, you're laying over in Miami and you live in Miami. Your trip just happens later there. You don't need your hotel room. You could call up, cancel your hotel room, and then receive stipend for that cancellation. They're saving money by not having the hotel used, therefore pass some of that savings along to you. Right now there's no incentive for a flight and to cancel their room, so the room just goes unused. We'd like to see that, so we could get some money into flight attendants' pockets. However, it probably would come with some restrictions, right? Because you picked up the trip and canceled your room and then subsequently couldn't be on the trip, or that would pose a problem for the next person. So most unlikely it would come with some restriction about being able to drop the trip after you exercise that provision.
Hey, thanks, Tim. I'm going to skip around a little bit here so we can get some of these questions in that we haven't touched. One of them is, have you confirmed getting a hotel paid by the company for CQ if you're a commuter and based in Dallas? Susan?
Yes, we have. As reported in our November 22nd hotline, we did reach an agreement with the company that Dallas-based flight attendants who live more than 50 miles from Dallas will receive a hotel room for CQ and any associated training before or after CQ, in addition to base-specific training. So that's a great win for Dallas-based flight attendants. And regarding training, we've had many questions about training pay. We are definitely seeking an increase in training pay. We know especially there's more and more online training that we do not believe we are compensated enough for that or CQ. So that's something we're looking for as well.
Thanks, Susan. Hey, Brian, this one's for you. VE, voluntary extension, a significant increase in pay or percentage if a flight attendant offers to extend their duty time. Can you talk to them about what we propose?
Absolutely. If you go and can follow up onto our webpage and under sections 11 hours of service and section 14 international, we have proposed an increase to the VE with a 200% for 0 to 3 hours of extended time, with an additional 300% from hours 301 to 6 hours, of course, with your approval to take those extensions. This has been proposed for to meet both domestic and IPD for non-long range. Additional information will be on our web pages under those sections that refer to the extended long range flying and what we propose for those.
Thanks, Brian. Okay, Wendy, is the union negotiating for higher compensation for holidays than just $75? Not this last time. Because we should get at least get time and a half in addition to our pay. Do you want to address that?
Yes, we absolutely are seeking more than $75. That is just way too low. We haven't proposed exactly what that holiday pay will be, but we are seeking an increase. The past holiday perfect attendance and incentive program that was over November and December was very successful, and the company has even acknowledged that. So hopefully we'll able to get something similar or the same thing, and we're seeking more holidays that will be covered.
Thank you. Okay, I think we saw holiday pay more than $75 definitely worked, right? So everyone can stay tuned for that.
All right, Susan, I've got one here. Is anything being done to address the training section of the contract? I think you already did address the pay, right?
Right.
Okay, so I think we've already got that one because I think that's what this is.
Yeah, the Dallas, not a ton, it's getting the hotel.
Getting the hotel, right. Okay, and we're getting down there. And I think we addressed this early on, but Reese, we might want to say it again. Can we please change TTS so that reserves can pick up and trip trade to improve a scheduling assigned or ETP awarded trip?
Yes, so we are proposing reserve use of TTS and UBL on days off or after release from a reserve day. This will enable reserves to use their seniority to pick up time instead of being processed after all line holders and available reserves like it is today. And this will give reserves greater access to red flag, which could have effects on how many reserves are used during an IROP situation, because now that their pool of people picking up red flag and available trips is greater because it will include line holders and available reserves, then reserves that are actually on a RAF that day may not end up being used. So that'll hopefully have reverberations down the line.
Thank you.
All these all are working together.
Yeah. Okay, we have one last one here. Wendy, in-flight crew rest, our previous contract prior to the JCBA, if crew rest was offered on one leg of your trip, it was guaranteed on both legs. Do you want to address this one?
Sure. This is something we have asked for in our proposal in crew rest section 38, and it is somewhere we are a company that is not in agreement with that. So that section has been tabled, so we will be coming back to that, but that is something that the company at this time is not wanting to give us, but we are asking for it.
We are demanding. I will say, at least for myself, and I hope for the rest of this team, I'm really happy that we have everything on the website that our flight attendants can see. I've been flying for a very long time. I can tell you before I was a negotiator or I even worked in the union, I always wondered, what is the negotiating team negotiating? So I hope that all of you will go to our website and you will view each of the sections, but especially if you don't want to stay up to date with it all the time, especially go to our hotlines and see what our latest proposals have been, and then go to the section and see what we're proposing back and forth. There is a lot of information there. I know it's time consuming to try and keep up with it, but it's really important that you have the knowledge now, because in this process, when it comes down to the very end, when we get to where we've TA'd all of the sections, we have about 30 days to educate the membership. That's why we're doing this now. 30 days is not enough for us to educate you on all the changes that have been made to the contract. So please keep informed. It's one of the most important things you can do for your job, but also for your negotiations. So I want to thank everybody here for attending today, for answering all the questions. Thank you to all of the flight attendants who have joined us today. And for those of you who are viewing this later, it's really important that we give you as much information as we can. Please also join the contract action team. We want a bigger army. 1,200 is good, but we want more. And we will be calling on you soon. And when you go to the website, you can see what the fight is, the fights that we have, that we are trying to improve the lives of our flight attendants when they're at work, and also for when you're at home. So it's really important that we that you know what we're fighting for and that you're a part of this, because this is really about all of us and all our contract and our work. So thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, Joe, if you're still on, and we will see you next time. Please stay informed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.